From Temple University, this is Profiles in Literature, featuring interviews with authors and illustrators prominent in American literature for children. On this special adult books edition, we are pleased to have as our guest Mr. James A. Michener. Mr. Michener is a past recipient of the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction, whose works have sold over 6 million copies in 24 languages. With Mr. Michener are Mrs. Carolyn Field, Director of the Office on Work with Children of the Free Library of Philadelphia, Dr. Robert S. Marler, Director of the American Studies Program of Temple University, and Dr. Philip R. Yanella, Professor of English, Temple University. The moderator for this series is Dr. Jaqueline N. Shachter, Professor of Children's Literature with Temple University.
Mr. Michener, first a get acquainted moment. Before we meet you, I'd like to tell you that most of the members of the audience are made up of some of your favorite people, English teachers. They are here for the National Council of Teachers of English Convention and are part of a pre-convention study group on literary and historical backgrounds of Philadelphia. You're the local literary light they've chosen to honor. Before we discuss your books, I'd like to share with the audience some background information about Mr. Michener, and I ask you to interrupt me to comment freely.
Very good.
After being raised in nearby Doylestown, he received degrees from Swarthmore and the Colorado State College of Education. He won a Lippincott Traveling Fellowship to do research at the British Museum, and he was a graduate student at 6 other universities. English teachers here will be pleased to know that for 9 years he himself was a teacher, winding up as a visiting professor at Harvard. Thereafter, he was an associate editor for Macmillan. During World War II, he was in the United States Naval Reserves, discharged with the rank of Lieutenant Commander. He was stationed in the South Pacific, and there he coped with mosquitoes and humidity to write on the spot Tales of the South Pacific, which won the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction in 1948. Didn't the Pulitzer Advisory Committee have a ban on short story collections so that even though your stories were connected, wasn't it quite an honor for you to win that award?
I think that when the prize was announced for that year, everyone in the literary world in the United States was astonished, not the least of which was I. The Pulitzer Committee had never before given the prize for a group of interconnected short stories. They had never before given a prize where all the Americans were overseas and not at home. And they had very rarely given a prize to someone who was as little known as I was. Fortunately, it worked out well all the way around. It was the start of my writing career. And I am indeed indebted to those nameless judges, whoever they were, who had the courage to do that at that time in my life, because it got me launched on a professional career.
Well, this same book, you know, was the basis for the Broadway musical South Pacific, which played for 5 years, over 1,900 performances, and was later adapted into a film. Other books of his that have appeared as film adaptations include Sayonara, The Bridges at Toko Rii, Return to Paradise, and Hawaii. Did I leave any out?
Well, there are 3 or 4 others, but I'm not.
Please.
I'm not overwhelmingly proud of them. So
but I wish you would add.
I'm perfectly willing to let them die. There was one marvelous thing, Men of the Fighting Lady. which has never appeared on television earlier than 3 o'clock in the morning. And I've rarely seen an example of absolutely correct time slot. I've had very good luck with people who have adapted my works for other media. South Pacific, I think, was one of the great success films of all time. Tokari was the best film ever made from anything I've written. That's a splendid little movie. And Sayonara won several people Oscars because of the great performances they gave in it, not anything I had done. I'm very pleased with what other media have done with what I've written.
Well, now, you actually haven't done the scripts for any of these yourself.
No. I have, I think, one movie I haven't even seen yet myself.
Oh, really?
A splendid little movie on New Zealand that I did many years ago. I have never been involved in Hollywood or Broadway. I'm a writer. That's what I do best, and really, that's about all I can do. I leave all the rest to other people.
Well, I must say that some of these other people think they're writers, too, to the scripts, but I can understand.
By and large, I've been treated very well by Hollywood. A lot of people have gotten Oscars out of things I've written. There was a listing the other day of the 50 top films of all time, so far as acceptance was concerned, and three of mine were in it, which was unbelievable to me. But it represents, I think, a part of the fact that a storyteller, a man who can tell a great story, has an automatic step up in this world, that he has something which the world has always prized since the days of the cavemen, the man who can tell a narrative of what happened. Mm-hmm. And I would suppose my good luck stems from that basic fact.
You have explored other media to this extent. He was the originator of the television series Adventures in Paradise. I want to add that before Hawaii, more than 6 million copies of his books had been published in 24 languages. That's quite a staggering record. I have a question for you.
Yes.
You have been a prolific writer of both fiction and nonfiction, having to your credits over 25 books. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Now, do you consider yourself to be primarily a novelist? And if so, why?
You know, this is a very difficult question of classification, and I doubt that I'm qualified to answer it. I graduated from a small college not far from where we're sitting, Swarthmore, which was a very good college in those days, and is, I'm told, still. And I graduated near the top of my class, certainly, and was all set to be an English teacher for the rest of my life. And I was a moderately good one. I worked at it very hard. But at a rather advanced age of almost 30, I decided that I needed a rather broader field in which to experiment. And I started my education all over again and became a history teacher by the time I was 30. And 2 years later, I was teaching history at Harvard. The point is that I have all my life oscillated between pure fiction and pure nonfiction. And the sad fact is that when I'm writing a fiction book, with all of the responsibility on me alone, I do wish that I was writing nonfiction, where the thing is structured, the subject matter itself determines what comes next. And when I am writing nonfiction and I'm bound in, hemmed in by those requirements, I wish that I were a free agent writing fiction, able to do whatever I wanted to do, floating over the world of the imagination. And so I have been something of a tortured soul, oscillating between these two extremes. And I would suppose that today I would be rather unhappy if I did not oscillate between those extremes. I'm just finishing a long novel, one of the most difficult jobs I've ever undertaken. I've been working incredibly hard. And the next book I'm going to do is a short nonfiction book. I suppose I do this in response to some inner need, and if I were a different kind of person, I would write in a different way. I'd say one other thing. I have frequently had the suspicion that I would be a lot farther along if I had stayed home in Doylestown in a small house and written only fiction about the imaginary world that I once saw there. Well, that hasn't been my lot. I'm a different kind of person. That's for somebody else. I've done what I can do, and I've tried to do it very well.
You're also a journalist, and that is a distinct style of writing in order to be successful in that field. Do you think this has helped you in your fiction writing to fit it into the popular appeal, shall we say?
See, this is a neat point. People sometimes ask me why a man like me with so many good breaks in the field of writing would bother with politics, which I have done all my life and still do. And it seems to me that the question is the other way around, that if I had not been interested in politics, in the total structure of my society, I would not have written the kind of books I write. I'm not interested in politics because I'm a writer. I'm a writer because I'm interested in the human condition.
But you do not have a journalistic background.
No. I've never worked for a newspaper. I have great respect for men who do. Most of my close friends are newspaper men because I hold them in such high regard. Journalists of all kinds, I go on my vacations with them. I seek them out because I have enormous respect for them. I think that the job of holding a society together is a very intricate, complex job. And any of us who can contribute to it, newspaper people, teachers, college professors, you people who run libraries, political leaders, any of us who can work in any way to hold society together, perform an unusual service for this country. And I have always been involved in this. I've been very deeply involved in politics and would hope to be so until I die, because the structure of society is what makes life good. I've lived in unstructured societies, and they are really for the birds. They show me nothing. I want a heavily structured society in which somebody collects the garbage and somebody takes care of the sewage and somebody collects taxes and somebody says how fast you can ride in your automobile and somebody says that you've got to mow your lawn.
Mr. Michener, I'm interested in unstructured society. You say you've lived in unstructured societies.
Yes. I've lived on the frontier a great deal, as you may know, in the remote parts of Asia, where you couldn't drink the water, where you couldn't get penicillin, mm-hmm. where you couldn't buy a razor blade. I've lived there in the South Pacific. I've lived in the North a great deal. I have lived on the frontier most of my life. And I have seen the emptiness of the dream of an unstructured society. This really produces very little good living. Now, I think that when you get to a society like Spain's or Germany's under Hitler or Russia's under Stalin, you get an overstructure which kills the spirit. But I think that a country like Mexico, for example, or Canada, to take two of our neighbors, a kind of balance has been struck between pure freedom and the structure of responsibility. And I must say that I infinitely prefer that to the unstructured society.
Does this have an impact or an influence? The idea of structure is one that interests me immensely.
And does really?
Yes. It have an impact on your fiction, on your writing,
oh,
the
yes.
way you structure it.
Oh, yes.
And in that same regard, in putting together an imaginative work, by that I mean the fiction, yes, as opposed to nonfiction, and using the ideas of structure that you obviously have here, what kind of audience are you seeking out? Or do you ever, because you've got to put it together, you see,
yeah,
and I wonder what kind of audience you're working toward.
Now, that's a difficult question. I would have difficulty answering this one, Professor, if I did not have my track record before me. The fact is, I've worked in about 8 different fields. If I were to die tomorrow, I think there's a very good chance that the 2 books of mine which might be remembered are the book on Spain, Iberia, and one of my books on Oriental art, The Floating World. So I can honestly tell you that I have not structured my writing career to cater to the general public.
I see.
I mean, I have 8 or 9 books that probably nobody in this audience has ever even heard of. I write them because they well out of my personality. In 4 instances, I even had to pay to get them published. I've seen them live, and now they're big successes. Well, they are because I had that internal gut drive to do the thing that way.
But what about the fiction?
Now, the fiction is something else. Gee, I don't know. Here I have something like 6 books, each of which has sold around 5 million copies. That's unheard of. I mean, things like Hawaii and The Drifters and The Source, and Sayonara. And there I would suppose my attitude has been that I have something to say, and I jolly well want to see to it that a maximum number of people at least listen. And so I suppose there I'm caught up in the audience problem. Mm-hmm. Now, if I had spent my life, as I could have done, writing Son of South Pacific and South Pacific Jungles and South Pacific Adventure, I would be ashamed of myself, sure, because there I would have been plugging for the easy audience. Well, I've tried to strike a balance on that. That's all I can say.
I was looking for that further, because I can see what you're saying. But I was wondering about that structure, the social concept that you and that structure that
yes,
given an audience,
oh, yes,
the structuring process.
Oh boy, when I sit down to work on page 1, I have this very carefully drafted in my mind, and I want the reader to stay with me right to page 950, because if he does, he's going to get something good out of it. This I believe without question. I can tell a story. I can bring an infinite number of strands together. And if the reader will stay with me, I really believe at the end of it, he will come away with something. Well, that is my profession as a writer of narrative. And I brood about that a great, great deal. Gee, I work terribly hard on the structure of my book.
Yeah, well, that's the one I felt was key, and I wanted to pop at,
absolutely,
at this
you're
on,
dead
on,
right,
on theory a little bit, because underneath that structure, underneath that structure now, there's something else that has meaning, I suspect. I'm thinking about, The Fires of Spring has not been, yes, a great success as the others, but it's still, there is that brooding you mentioned, that undercurrent of a feeling or whatever. Now, is that something you're conscious of, or does it just happen to occur, or does it not occur?
Yeah, let me say that the structure is the sine qua non.
Okay.
That's what I start with. If I don't have a good structure, I back away from the thing. I think that the structure I used in The Source, have a very broken pattern,
difficult,
was the success of that book.
Yes.
Otherwise, it would have been a nothing, I fear. Well, I have a structure in my new book which is somewhat comparable, though not the average reader wouldn't see it. But until I get the structure, I have no confidence at all. But once I have it, then it's nothing. I don't bother about it. Then what I'm after is this underpainting, this repetition of images, this repetition of words.
Did you do the same amount of research for the new book that you did on The Source?
You know, research never bothers me a bit. I'm a fairly intelligent man. I know how good the libraries of America are.
Oh.
I know how to get around them. I know where the books are. And I take no pride in research at all. It is, as I've sometimes said, it's like praising me for doing research, which I've done a great deal of, is like praising a bus driver for knowing how to shift gears. You know, he better not get in the bus unless he knows how to do that. He's not eligible. Well, I think it's the same way. A writer deserves no merit for research. That's his profession. What he does deserve merit for is a noble structure, a splendid working out of ideas, an illumination. That's what writing is.
And the splendid character developments in The Fires of Spring, which you mentioned, some of your most memorable characters are from the poorhouse.
I read a lot. I know what my contemporaries are doing. And I can think of many of my contemporaries who are much better at character construction than I am. I can think of four or five who are infinitely better at dialogue than I am. And so I can go down the whole list of components. I am left with a residue that I may be better than some of my contemporaries, am able to get a noble structure going and keep it going to a conclusion. Well, all that means is that in any period, you have a wide variety of talent among your writers. I can't begin to handle dialogue or the lovely phraseology the way Eudora Welty does. She breaks my heart sometimes with what she can do with words, and I can't. I don't have that crystal simplicity that Truman Capote sometimes gets, or that patina that Gore Vidal can get, a man I admire very much. Certainly I don't have those profound drives that Saul Bellow and Bernard Malamud have, two men I revere extremely highly. I don't have that witty observation of an Osborne. I have what I have, and it's not trivial. And so I don't beat my brains out as, am I as good as Osborne, or am I as brilliant as John Barth, or am I as perceptive as Joyce Carol Oates? What I can do very well.
How did you serve your apprenticeship to learn your literary craft when you began so late?
That's interesting. I have an editor who gets very furious sometimes over these ads that appear in the Sunday. How do you know you can't write? He says he never meets anybody who wonders whether he can be a concert violinist without practice and learning the violin and learning to read music and going through the drudgery of an apprenticeship. He feels the same way about writing. Writing is the end product of a very sophisticated mind. One of the writers of my generation that I've liked most is Jack Kerouac.
Really?
Yes.
Your work is so very different from his.
Yep. With a wild, free imagination, breaking out into new forms, new words, new everything. Because here was a very intelligent, well-trained man who saw that as the solution. But he also knew the language, and he knew what narrative was. And I like men who do that. That's why I like this young fellow, Bartholomew, who uses words in a new way. The point is that none of these people ever sat down cold turkey and said, I am a writer. They all learned words and narrative and how to tell a story and how to enlist the sympathy of the reader. I was at the University of Nebraska not long ago by accident, and I had lunch with the English department, and they said they had just had Eudora Welty there giving the keynote speech for the 100th anniversary of the birth of Willa Cather. Mm-hmm. And the whole state was excited. Everybody was out paying honor to Willa Cather, their native daughter who had done so well. And Eudora Welty said a very profound thing, which I heard repeated several times in the state. She said, one must always remember that a work of art is a work,
of art. And Willa Cather and Jack Kerouac and Norman Mailer and Truman Capote and Saul Bellow know what words are. They know what narrative is. They know their trade. And to think that some clowns who just pick up a piece of paper and do what they do is inconceivable.
When you were in your 20s and 30s, the norm for an American writer in the 20th century has been to go through the process of publishing in very small magazines, going through the trial track. You seem to have burst into print in the mid to late 40s and were an immediate success.
You know, what you say is entirely true. It's a mystery to me, and I just thank God it happened. And if somebody else asked, how could he do the same thing? I simply would not know. I was so lucky, it's inconceivable.
Well, did being an editor at Macmillan help at all in your own writing?
Well, I think what helped most was going to a very good high school where I learned something, and going to an even better college where I learned what literature was. And then the widest possible reading, constant study, constant comparison of what other people were doing. I would digress on that for a moment, because what you ask, Professor, is a very searching question. How do you learn? How do you break in?
Well, I have another part to that question, if I could.
Well, why don't you shoot that for, go ahead.
Did you ever take a creative writing course?
I did not.
Thank you, for the record.
I did not, but I think I gave myself one, in that as a young man, I read the man who still remains my god, Balzac. And I knew Balzac at 18 and 19 better than I would ever know Dickens or Thackeray or Thomas Wolfe or Sinclair Lewis. I read Dostoevsky. The two best books I ever read in my life, judging from the time I read them and what they meant to me, were Samuel Butler's Way of All Flesh and Arnold Bennett's The Old Wives' Tale. Hmm. I think a book is good for a person if it hits him when he needs it. And these two books gave me a new view of the world, a radically new view of the world. Butler's Way of All Flesh just bowled me over. The Old Wives' Tale is just an absolutely staggeringly beautiful account of two women in Middle England. I don't think a reader today would particularly like it. It's an old-fashioned book. But it hit me when I was right. The same thing could be said of Thackeray's Vanity Fair, which would be maybe the third book in this, or some of Tolstoy. So that I taught myself what literature was in the hardest school of all, reading books that were better than I could ever conceivably write myself. I think that's where the training comes.
And that's where a good English teacher at any level, elementary, secondary, or college, can inspire and motivate.
I am sure that if I were 40 years younger and had been going to school some time ago, that the Catcher in the Rye would have absolutely broken my horizon open. Whereas some of the other books that people talk about, I don't think would have hit me very much. For example, I miss Thomas Wolfe completely. You know, I was out of the country when he burst on the scene. I was, in a sense, beyond him. I'd gone into the great European writers. To my sorrow, I miss Fitzgerald completely. He doesn't loom that big in my life. On the other hand, Hemingway was explosive. And I think that the writing mind is a mind that has an infinite number of antennae all the time, and that when it comes into contact with something like Hemingway or The Old Wives' Tale or Flaubert, Madame Bovary, it immediately senses that these are answers to the questions that we have been asking, and then we don't need to ask those questions anymore. In other words, I didn't need Tom Wolfe. I didn't need James Branch Cabell. I didn't need many of the great figures of American literature because I leapfrogged over them.
Thank you very, very much, Mr. Michener. We are delighted to welcome our native son, the native son who has brought the Pacific world into almost every American home. We're particularly proud that you, who traveled all over, have chosen your birthplace in Bucks County, outlying Philadelphia, as your permanent home. Thank you for being our guest.
Thank you very much.